This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland at the end of the year. We're wishing you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year with this terrific Dreamland special event. Get set for something really extraordinary. The special will run over the next 2 weeks, and then we begin again. The new year will be upon us. What adventures await? Welcome to Dreamland's 2021 year-end special. It'll run for 2 weeks across the holidays, and it's going to be a very special this year because we have the observers with us. We're going to be looking at the future, what it may bring in terms of what we hope for, what we expect, and what we fear. The observers are the group of people who participated in the documentary of the same name, which you can find now on Amazon Video, Apple TV, iTunes, Vimeo, Google Play, Vudu, and Microsoft Streaming. They are, in order of appearance on the show, John Greenewald, Deb Kauble, William Henry, Richard Dolan, and Jimmy Church. Linda Moultonhowe and I got so involved that we talked for over an hour, and so Linda Moultonhowe's part of the observers will lead off 2022. It'll be our first show of what will be an extraordinary year indeed, 2022. Sadly enough, Lou Elizondo could not be with us for this show. I want to wish everybody Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year from all the crew here at Dreamland and Unknown Country and from the observers. John Greenewald, one of the observers, was last on Dreamland in 2019 when we discussed his incredible website, The Black Vault, and what he has been doing there. John began in 1996 at the age of 15, hammering the U.S. government with Freedom of Information Act requests. 2 decades later, the Black Vault is the biggest repository of its kind in the world. John has played an enormous role in pressuring the government to reveal what has never should have been secret. Welcome to Dreamland, John, and let me ask you now the first question. What is your greatest hope for 2022?
You know, it's an exciting time we live in, and as we enter 2022, I truly hope when it comes to the UFO conversation, it continues to develop as it has. And even though it was December of 2017 when word really kind of broke about this secret Pentagon UFO study and the conversation started to change, in my personal opinion, I feel it's been really the last year or so where it's really excelled, where we have a government UAP report, which although in some ways was a letdown, it was exciting to see that come to fruition. Now we have new legislation looking like it's going to go through and potentially mandate periodic reports from the government. I think that that's a very interesting development and one that I want to see continue in 2022. I'm apprehensive, of course, when it comes to the government's involvement in anything. And when they tell us something, I've got 3 million pages on the blackvault.com now, which have shown me over the course of 25 years, they're not always the most honest bunch of people that we can speak with. So I do have my apprehensions, but I hope that the public conversation stays the way that it's been going. And that is one of a serious tone. That is one where people are more open to things that may challenge their beliefs that they've held for their whole life. But now the conversation is changing and maybe challenging those lifelong beliefs for many people. So I would love to see that continue.
I wonder if it will, because we have essentially the same unit in the Pentagon that is doing this now was the unit that was keeping the secrets.
Yeah.
I'm concerned that they're just going to play games with us.
Well, that's a smart mindset to be in, Whitley, and that's where my apprehension is, simply because when the government is involved in anything, you have to take it with a little bit of skepticism and maybe arguably a lot of skepticism, because we don't know what they're going to use the UFO phenomena for and that conversation. Very recently in the last year or so, I've talked a lot about the counterintelligence value to the UFO phenomena, that it can be utilized for a few different things in a counterintelligence effort. And that is covering up, let's say, the percentage of this phenomena that is explainable, Earth-based technology, classified tech, that type of stuff. But on the other hand, there's a percentage that they can't explain, that there's a percentage that lacks any explanation or identification at all. And so they can create this smokescreen around the story as a whole for their benefit. And so that's where I talk about the counterintelligence value to this, because they can use it. And in turn, when the public says, hey, give us a report, and legislation mandates, give us a report, give us an update of what you have, how do we know that that's the truth? Because we've been dealing with this for 70 plus years, that the government has lied to us, that they have not been truthful about the UFO topic. So why are they going to start now? And that's something that really, I would say, perplexes me, simply because how do we know who to believe or what to believe or when to believe it?
You know, the lying, it's understandable at first because they didn't know what was going on. The Roswell crash happened 30 miles from an extremely sensitive airbase. So they would have covered it up, especially because the Cold War was just beginning. Stalin was becoming extremely aggressive. And it was a scary time. But then, as Art Exon said, everyone from Truman knew that what we had found was not of this world within 24 hours of our finding it. Then, a few months later, the Twining memo appears, and he was the head of air materiel at Wright Field, so he must have known exactly what they had. Now, why did they keep it secret when they knew it wasn't a threat from, say, Russia?
Well, because I think potentially to the American people, it was a threat not necessarily from the Soviet Union or from China or whomever at the time, but rather somewhere else. And the technology advances to traverse the stars is something that America can't combat, whether it be 2022 or whether it be 1947. So I think that there was a fear that the general public just couldn't handle that truth. And the Robertson panel in 1952 through the CIA, that I think kind of proves this theory a bit, where the national security risk more than all else at that time in 1952 was essentially the American people themselves, that they were able to overwhelm the resources of, let's say, the emergency systems and stuff like that, that if they started talking about UFOs, feeling that they were a threat and that that was a national security risk. And so what the CIA wanted to do after the Robertson panel convened was essentially explain, not necessarily investigate. Maybe they already had the answers. I mean, we can argue that too, but not necessarily investigate, but essentially say, explain this. So the science goes out the window, and rather a concerted effort to cover up the reality of what it really is, or the reality of how they're clueless. And to me, that also is a huge possibility here, where they just have absolutely no idea what is going on, not discounting extraterrestrials at all, but rather counting that as a high on the list, but really just kind of flailing, trying to understand the true dimension of this phenomena and all facets of it. So there was a lot there, I think, that played a role in the national security angle. And I think that that's why they kept us all in the dark and have for decades upon decades. And if I can quickly add, just to close the thought, fast forward to now, the conversation has changed. Now they're not afraid to say that they're unidentified, that they don't know, that they're not Russia or not China. And I think that maybe, and this is just speculation, but maybe they've learned over the last X amount of decades trying to cover this up, that people like me and you and maybe a lot of your audience, we're not going away. We see the phenomena as real. We see it needing scientific scrutiny, and we see it as something that should be in our conversation. So I think now on their side, they're flipping their tactic a little bit. Instead of just denying the whole thing and trying to kind of just sweep it under the carpet and make it go away, now it's kind of like hiding it in plain sight, where they can fall back on, well, we're investigating it. We don't really know what it is. And now they have a counterintelligence tool that they can use in their toolbox, again, for creating a shroud of secrecy over the entire phenomena, the section that they may know what it is, and then the section that they don't know what it is. But it's a very powerful tool, I think, for them to utilize.
You know, let's get down to the very basics at this point. You have millions of people who've had various types of close encounters, contact, seen UFOs up close, millions of them around the world. And we don't even know how many abduction experiences have actually occurred outside of the Anglo-Saxon world, because they haven't been reported at all. And there's no reporting system, so we just don't know. The only country in the world which has really gotten into this deeply is the United States. And I don't know whether that means the American people were more affected by this than others or not. But now that we have all of this, and we know that the people are directly involved, it would seem to me that that might be a motive behind the slight lessening of secrecy, because the people need to understand. They need to understand. They have a right to. Do you think that could be a factor?
Yeah, I don't disagree. The question is, do the majority of the people have the ability to accept it? And that I wrestle with that. I really do. I want to believe that we all can accept that reality of an extraterrestrial presence, or the fact that they've traversed the stars and they're here. I want to believe that the general public is ready for that as a whole. I just don't. I think that our audiences, respectively, you know, on your show, my show, and shows like it, yeah, absolutely, I believe that they can, because they have chosen to look at evidence and be open to that idea. Some are convinced, some are on the fence, but they're open to it. But that, sadly, is not the majority of the general population. You know, the general population nowadays, I mean, you look at just how people have reacted through this pandemic alone. And, you know, there's a meme and funny image that floats around. You can insert any image you want, but the tagline is, this is why the aliens don't visit, or this is why the aliens don't talk to us, you know. And it's just kind of a silly thing. But in the same respect, it really does show a window to our society as a whole that we can't cooperate together properly. And how could we accept such a mind-blowing revelation when the majority of the population, you know, is busy arguing about wearing a mask and freedoms and this and that? And I don't want to in any way turn it political, but my point is that people are arguing about such minuscule ideas and rioting over less. Imagine such an extraordinary revelation being blasted to the planet. I don't think the reaction would be as good as I would want it to be.
I have to agree with you, but I also think that we've got to face it at some point.
Sure.
Interestingly enough, as I always say, whatever is here agrees entirely with the government about the secrecy, because if it didn't, this wouldn't be secret, because they obviously have the capability of coming out basically whenever they want to, but they mm-hmm. don't. So to me, that means they agree with the secrecy. What do you think might change all of this? Because I have a feeling that we're on a trajectory to some kind of revelation here. What do you think might happen in that respect?
I'm not sure. There's a lot of different ideas of what disclosure with a capital D is when we get that undeniable proof. And for a lot of people, it's the government, which I'm always surprised at because people are... Yeah, because people are so distrusting of the government, and it's like the same voices that have preached that are thinking that maybe new legislation is going to, you know, pave the way for some type of disclosure. And I don't see it that way. I mean, it's very hard to trust the government on this topic. So for them to just do a 180 and disclose everything, how could we believe them then? How do we know that that's the full truth? So there's a lot that goes into that. What I think needs to happen is the scientific community, the ones that and I'm sorry to say it this way, I hope it doesn't come off wrong, but the ones that we have not heard about in the UFO conversations, not the skeptics, right? So not those ones that are always out blasting the UFO conversation and topic, and also those that are not really, I would say, taking it seriously. I think we need like the third parties, the ones that haven't considered it yet. I think that they would need to see something or be presented evidence in a way that it's, I would say, unbiased, because those that have really become pro in the scientific community and those that have become very negative in the scientific community, despite what they may say, I think there's a bias there. So that's what I mean about the scientific community, the portion thereof that hasn't seen the evidence yet, get introduced to it and not be afraid to sit down and analyze it and see what type of science. And I think it's the science that's going to drive this conversation. You know, there may be some other very advanced aspect to this phenomena that our science hasn't caught up to yet. But I do believe that there's a very three-dimensional 21st century way of looking at this that we would as a people understand. So I don't think it's going to be a government or a world government, American or otherwise, that's going to really put this to the forefront. I think it's going to be science. How that happens, I'm not sure. But I think it is going to have to be something that is absolutely irrefutable that's put in front of the people of Earth for us to truly believe it.
John Greenewald, theblackvault.com. And how do we listen to your podcast?
So theblackvault.com is really kind of the roadmap to everything. You'll see a link for the podcast on there. I do video live streams all the time, presentations for dissecting government documents and new finds. So I have a lot of fun with that. But the easiest way, theblackvault.com, everything is in the menu, pretty much laid out in that way.
John, thank you so much for being with us on Dreamland, and we're going on into 2022, folks.
Yeah, scary. But Whitley, it's a pleasure. Thank you so much for inviting me.
With us now is Deb Kauble. Debbie was, what was your name in Intruders?
Kathy Davis.
Kathy Davis of Intruders, of Bud Hopkins's Intruders. Now she is very different, has had a long life since Intruders. She now has written a book called Extraordinary Contact about her experiences, and you can get to know Deb at debshome.com. Now, our rule for the Observers year-end show is we ask two questions. What are your hopes for 2022, and what are your fears for 2022? And you can answer them in any way you would like. We'll start with hopes. And it's a little bit more open-ended. In other words, it's not just two questions. You may say things that bring up other questions in the time we have together, and that's fine. So, hopes for 2022.
Well, I hope, got my fingers crossed, that the stigma that surrounds people like you and I who've had these experiences and who have been vocal and out there talking about them goes away, at least for the most part. I mean, it's already a lot better than it was 38 years ago, but I'm hoping that more and more people are going to feel comfortable talking about their experiences, because I feel like just about everybody has something weird and most people aren't talking about it. I feel like for every person like me and you who are out there speaking about it in public, there's probably 10,000 people sitting at home listening to us and thinking, ooh, you know, I got this thing, but I'm not going to say anything. I don't want to get fired, or, you know, I don't want people to ostracize me. I want that to go away. I want pilots and military people to feel comfortable reporting things that they see. And I just really want, and my hope is that people will wake up, that they'll realize that we're not alone in this world, that they'll realize that there's a lot more about life going on around them than they've seen with their eyes and heard with their ears. And I mean, that's my hope. And my dream is that people realize how connected we are to each other, how much we need each other, and how strong and potent our thoughts are, and how we can all come together and make this a better place for everybody. You know, that's my hope. That's my hope for 22, that it at least starts in that direction. That's a big order for 1 year, but
yeah. Because, you know, there's still, if you go on late night television after a big UFO release like the Tic Tac or the Gimbal videos when they were released, the New York Times story, or the threat assessment, you still find the late night hosts scoffing and playing the old humiliation game just like they always did. And the scientific community, for the most part, isn't buying it at all. They'd much rather listen to someone say, oh, well, it was reflections on the cockpit window or a flock of birds, than face the truth.
I hope they all get abducted. That's bad.
What do you think might happen to change things?
I personally don't think that disclosure is going to come from our government or any government. I think it's going to come from them. I think they're going to do what they want to do in their own time. And I hope that they feel like, okay, it's time. Let's go. You know, I think that something is going to happen that nobody can hide. Maybe that millions of people are going to see. And although, you know, it's hard telling with human beings anymore the way they act, but hopefully they'll believe their own eyes.
Well, whatever the visitors do, it's likely to be fairly asymmetrical, knowing them. I mean, in other words, it's going to be something that nobody really expects. But I agree with you. I don't think the government can come clean for two reasons. One is, obviously, the aliens, if indeed they are that, haven't come clean. They are in hiding. So whatever policy of secrecy the government has, they must agree with. But I don't think that the bureaucracy is going to be able to fess up. I think it's going to have to be pulled out of them. And I think the only way for it to be pulled out of them is, you're right, they have to, the visitors have to come out somehow. Can you imagine any specific ways? Do you have any intuition about that?
No, I mean, I've thought about it many times. I just feel, I don't know, like it would have to be something global.
Yeah.
You know?
Either very big or very small. I mean, big. If they were incontrovertibly videotaped by a close encounter witness, undeniably, then there would be denials, but it would work, and that would be sort of a next step.
And it might maybe have to do with the person that it happens to. If it's on a small scale, the person that it happens to, the person that's contacted by them and has this evidence, I think that might make a difference as well.
Yeah.
You know, somebody that's big, somebody
like
that's well known,
star or something,
or a big politician.
Big politician would be a possibility.
Yeah.
Except then that would identify them with politics. And as far as I can tell, in all the years I've been involved with them, I've not seen anything from them, either in terms of what people describe as communication from them, or what people, how they communicate to people, that has much of anything to do with our politics.
Yeah, or our religion either. Same with me.
Same thing, yeah. Mm-hmm. Except for climate change or environmental danger and nuclear. Those are the two things that they seem concerned about. Because, I mean, they've bothered all these nuclear sites and missile sites and stuff, and that message of environmental danger is so prevalent in the reports that people have of contact. So
I feel like we're toddlers, you know, as far as nuclear goes, I think like we're like toddlers playing with matches, and
exactly.
You know, and they're like, no, 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 that's bad. You could burn yourself.
Well, you know, we've got 440 nuclear reactors on planet Earth right now in private sector, in the civil sector, not necessarily private, in all countries. And all of those reactors have to constantly be maintained by a flow of electricity from the outside, or they'll melt down. And in other words, they have to have pumps and water and so forth and so forth. And there's going to come a time when that electricity is not there, for sure. And those things are going to melt down. And I'm sure that the visitors anticipate this. Okay, we've gotten fairly far with the hopes, and we've sort of bled into the fears kind of naturally.
Yeah.
Fears, concerns.
That we're going to destroy the place before we ever get a chance to meet them outwardly, you know.
Yeah, to really meet them.
Like
on our terms.
On our terms, and with our, you know, awareness, everybody's awareness, and everybody focused in the, you know, everybody accepting it, however, whether they like it or not, you know. But I'm afraid we're going to destroy our planet or our species.
I think there are just too many people. I don't think it's really our fault in a way. I mean, it's just the way we're built. We have a tendency to create a lot of children, and we've ended up overpopulated. I mean, Thomas Malthus, back in the 18th century, predicted just mathematically that this would happen, and it has exactly as he predicted. So it, but it's still, you know, all the children in the world are facing this, and frankly, I think everyone from your generation on down is going to face this, these tremendous changes that are coming to the planet. Not my generation, because I mean, let's face it, I've only got a few years left for sure, unless I turn into one of those real thousand-year-old men or something. Mel Brooks used to do that bit. I don't think so, somehow. But what if they aren't friendly? You know, Bud was very convinced that this was a really bad thing that was going on. But how do you feel about that now?
I don't feel like that. I'm not convinced that it's all malevolent, because I feel like if they really had mouth toward us and they really disliked us that much, we'd already be gone, because they're more than capable of that. It may be that they just are indifferent, like when, you know, we watch an anthill being built. Maybe that's how that is, you know. People used to ask me all the time, why didn't you ask them questions, and why didn't you have conversations with them when I was in, you know, remembering having been in contact with them. I did later on, but when I was young, I was just afraid of dying. And I always felt like to them, it would be like them trying to explain, like me trying to explain to an aunt how to balance a checkbook.
Yeah,
that's right. What's the point, you know? So,
well, there's also the ant elephant analogy, where the ant and the elephant might like each other very much, but they both have to be really careful in different ways. The ant's got to be damn careful it doesn't get trampled by the elephant, and the elephant's got to really walk very carefully, or he'll crush the ant. Mm-hmm. Not because they want to, but because that's just the difference between them. And do you get the feeling that they are really just millions of years ahead of us, or just a little bit ahead of us, or maybe 1,000 years? Or how do you feel? Is there any fit in the relationship, do you think, or is it just the huge gulf between us?
Well, I think there's more than one. I think I've had contact with more than one kind of thing. And I definitely feel like at least one thing that I've had contact with is like hundreds of thousands of years advanced of us, and maybe even us 100,000 years in the future. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I also feel like there is another kind of life around us that we don't see, that's right here where we are on some different plane of existence.
I could not agree with you more. That's a great insight.
And I feel like there are people in, like, I visualize these bubbles, like I've said before, then these two soap bubbles touch. This is my universe. This is their universe. In this little space where this bubble touches is where communication can happen. And it moves because the bubbles slide around on each other and that little touch point moves. I feel like there's people in that bubble who are aware of us. And I believe there are people here in our bubble that are aware of them, and they're actively both working on ways to communicate with each other and basically, you know, prove to the world that there's other life out there. I feel like, you know, we're only seeing a little sliver of what's going on all around us. I know my brain can't, and my eyes can't see the Wi-Fi signals that are going through my room right now, but they're there. You know,
right. I get where you're coming from.
So I feel like there's something like that is going on too. I think it's more than just one thing happening. I think there's a lot of stuff happening.
Well, when I've been out of my body, I've seen things that are in this world that you do not see with your regular eyes, a lot of strange things. And so I agree with you completely. And I was thinking, when you say they might be 100,000 years ahead or even farther, I was thinking to myself, if an ancient Roman was pulled up to like 1820, he would basically understand the world. It would have been carriages and horses. Everything would have worked better than he had known in his world. But it would be basically the same world, a world lit only by fire and powered basically by horse flesh with here and there a steam engine. The Romans had steam too. They just didn't understand how to use it. But if you take someone from 1820 to now, forget about it. They would think they were on some planet from a million years ahead of them. Mm-hmm. It would be unbelievable to them. So
maybe they're not that far advanced from
maybe
us.
Maybe they're not. Just... And if they're not that far advanced, I mean, let's face it, mankind, I think, is basically a good species. But we're dangerous. We're not the most ethical in the world, and we do have a tendency to exploit others when they're weaker than we are. So if it's somebody who's like 200 years ahead of us and they find us, we might have reason to worry.
Or they might. They might, because we like to shoot at things that we don't understand.
We've been doing that since the 50s when it comes to this, for sure.
Yeah. But what if time is just a big, like everything is happening right now. And, somewhere somebody's figured out how to slide in and out of different chunks of time. You know what I mean? But because it's all happening right now. So I don't know. I think about strange stuff sometimes. I get some weird.
Yeah, well, you have a wonderful mind in that respect. I've always greatly enjoyed your work and your blog and stuff. It's very cool stuff.
No.
They always choose interesting people. I'll say that for sure, Deb.
Well, you're a pretty interesting guy yourself.
Well, look at the whole Close Encounter experience. All the people, the public people are really, a lot of them are really deep people. And if you look on my website, which is sort of a social gathering place for people who've had this experience, and there's lots of other places like that too, these are not idiots, and these are not, people with hyped up crazy ideas for the most part. Most of them are very serious, thoughtful people, not necessarily buying into all of the stories. And I want to ask you another question. There's a sort of basic story going around that there are three species here, the reptilians, the greys, and the Nordics, and they're sort of all in conflict in some way. And I wonder about that story, and I'm not saying I'm questioning it because that's not my job, but I wonder what you think of that story.
I've heard it too. I've heard it for a long time.
Me too.
And I know I've seen and had an interaction with the gray guys. That's what I call them, the gray guys. And I have had interaction with some human-looking people that were, I guess, could be considered Nordic type, very attractive and very human-looking, although odd in behavior. But I've never had any contact with anybody or anything that would have been considered reptilian. I mean, that doesn't mean it isn't true. I've just never had any contact with it. So I feel like I can't make a judgment call on something like that I don't know anything about.
I'm in the same boat. Exactly. I've been in contact. I've been interacted with the grays and the big blonde people, but not with anything that I would consider a reptilian.
Yeah, no, me either. So I don't know, I hear they're horrible, nasty, mean things. And
they look ugly, but spiders look ugly too, but they're actually very helpful. If you have a spider in your house, it's mm-hmm. not only good luck, but they're eating all kinds of other little nasty insects that actually are nasty.
Unless it's my late husband used to make bat boxes
or something.
Yeah, no, I'm not a big spider fan, but I don't kill anything. So if they're in my house, we have a conversation. I'll say, you know, if you stay up there in the corner, you can hang around as long as you want, but stay out of my shoes and my bed. And I'll take them outside.
Spider in my bedroom for quite a while. And, you know, we got along. She would come down in early morning off her web on the ceiling, and she'd come down, and I thought, you know, she's looking me over, but why is she hoping I'm not as big as I look, or maybe she could have a meal, or what is it? But anyway, she's gone there because their lives are very brief.
Yeah.
Well, okay. Let me ask you another question. This is so interesting to me because you know, you're very articulate about some really deep stuff. Here's a situation. You are the person who gets video of the visitors. They come into your house, you videotape them, you've got a good camera, you do it in such a way that only someone who is a professional liar is going to deny this. What do you do with it? What's your next step?
What would I do? I would probably contact like you and Yvonne and Linda, and I would ask for you guys' advice because I trust you, and you know, I know you guys would have my best interests and also have good ideas about how we can get that out to as many people. I would feel it was real important to get it out to as many people all over the world as possible.
Right.
And, you know, if people, I don't mind, you know, scientists who want to look at it or whatever, like that would be great too. But yeah, I think my first move would be to just contact you guys because I feel like you guys are way smarter than me and you would know better what to do with it.
I'm not so sure we're way smarter than you, but you know what? I think that I've thought about this a lot, and I think that we have a very interesting foundational infrastructure in the media. We could bring it to people like Ralph Blumenthal and Leslie Kane, who are, Ralph Blumenthal is a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist. And, you know, and you have him and Leslie with her tremendous reputation and the New York Times. And we would get, we could probably get a lot of support in the scientific community. There are people with very big scientific reputations like Gary Nolan, who would be on our side, and Jacques Vallée, of course, too.
Mm-hmm.
So it's actually possible now for someone like you or me or any of us Close Encounter witnesses to end up in this situation and for it to work so it is actually expressed into the world in a way that would be useful. And I think that's quite new.
Well, I mean, I'm hammered
it's
up
not
to
like
the hill.
New yesterday, but new for the over the past 5 years.
Yeah, right. Yes, and technology. I mean, everybody has cameras now. Everybody has good cameras on their cell phones. I have an iPhone 12 Pro Max, and that camera is better than anything I ever bought, you know, before.
Yeah.
And then I have cameras all around my house. I have the Ring. Security cameras, the Ring doorbell cameras. I mean, there's a million ways to capture stuff now.
Right. And my house is full of surveillance cameras because I always hope the visitors will relent because they come in here physically every once in a while. I'm convinced of it. Mm-hmm. The reason I'm convinced of it is all the surveillance cameras turn themselves off when that happens. And, you know, why would a surveillance camera turn itself off for no reason? And who would do it? How?
Maybe one of these days they'll let us.
Well, let's leave it there.
Them. Yeah.
Deb Kauble and Whitley Strieber, visitors, we're asking you, come on and sit down across the table from us for a few minutes when we have a good camera. Deb's ready. I'm ready. A lot of us, Close Encounter Witnesses, are ready. And not only that, we can do this. And we can get it out into the scientific community, the academic community, and the media in a good way. So listen up. It's time.
It's time. And I'm ready. I won't be scared anymore. I'm, I promise.
Well, I'll probably be scared. I'm easily scared. But I'm also one of those cusses that doesn't stop anyway. So I'll keep going. I would like to thank you for being with us. And as I have said to all of the observers, the same thing. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to you, too.
It's been great. We'll talk again soon. We'll have a long dreamland together and just explore all of this stuff as deeply as we can.
That sounds great.
Thanks for being with me.
Thanks for asking.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. Okay, now another of the observers, William Henry, is with us. His website is williamhenry.net. He takes tours to Egypt, which are probably the best in the world, if you do not buy into the conventional wisdom, but really want some genuine wisdom, go to Egypt with William. It's a 5-star tour from beginning to end, led by arguably one of the greatest voices and minds in the field, William Henry. Also, in April, there is Halo 2.0 in Nashville. And I have been to some of William Henry's presentations on ascension and the light body. This is powerful, wonderful stuff. If you can get there, physically there, do it. It's very well worth your time. In fact, my whole relationship post-mortem with Annie really started at one of William's presentations in Nashville, when one of the participants walked up to me and said, "Mr. Strieber, something very strange just happened to me." And I said, "Well, what is it?" And she says, "Well, I'm a little embarrassed." I said, "You're talking to the right person when it comes to strangeness. Don't be embarrassed." And she said, "I just heard your wife's voice say, 'I can see Whitley when he's in the chair.'" And that... Wow. Caused a huge realization in my life that the sensing exercise causes us to become visible in other levels of reality. And I have used it ever since to maintain my communication with my wife, which is probably the most valuable thing in my life. And it all started in one of his presentations. So, okay, now, William, let's get on with it. I've talked about you for a couple of minutes, and I've hardly touched the surface. But I want you to talk to us about the future. I thought your presentation in The Observers about the dangers of artificial intelligence was incredibly powerful. But I'd like to start with your hopes for the future. What do you hope for in 2022? What would you like to see happen?
Well, I have high hopes for 2022. I mean, hope and fear are kind of intermingled at this time. And what we're called upon to do is to transmute any fear that we have into the higher vibration of hope and love and beyond. And the reason that I have high hopes, Whitley, is, and this goes back to 2012. Remember, back in 2012, we were talking about Revelation chapter 20, verse 12 is Judgment Day. And back in 2012, we knew we were entering into this time of immense transformation. We also got word that programs like Prism were in effect, that were literally reading all of our emails and recording all of our phone calls, and that indeed that AI was on the way that would be judging every thought, every action, every word that comes out of our mouths. And what that establishes is that we are in a period of revelation. We're in a period of fulfillment of prophecy, or appear to be, to many people, to be so. So my high hope comes from the book of Revelation, chapters 20 through 22, Revelation 20, 22. Well, what do we find? We find an angel. We find an angel, an otherworldly, possibly extraterrestrial being, coming out of heaven with a chain in its hand that chains Satan and the dragon, the very same beast that wants to implant us with the mark of the beast and augment us, mutate us into AI human hybrids. That very same being is going to be challenged, and in fact, possibly subdued, if the book of Revelation is correct. The Revelation 20 through 22 talks all about this otherworldly being subduing the dragon with this chain and throwing it in a pit for 1,000 years. So if we are following along the path of Revelation, as it appears to many that we are, then we have hope, because we are about to have an intervention in this scenario. And that's what we need, I feel, more than anything. AI has been allowed to run rampant on this planet now, unimpeded. And it is a predator. Make no mistake. Humanity has not had a predator other than ourselves for many thousands of years. We do now. And that is AI. And now, fortunately, we're looking at, according to Revelation, an intervention, an otherworldly being coming in and giving us assistance. That's why I have hope.
I'm open mouthed. That's brilliant. And I hadn't really realized that the verses of Revelation were actually messages to these eras, this era, but I can see where they are. And it's because something that was said to me at some point, and I can't say that it was said by the visitors or by the dead, but it was said by another level. And it was that the judgment will end when we know the limits of time. In other words, when we know that the end of time is coming, the judgment ends, and when the judgment ends, everybody is in the place that they belong, right, forever. That is
beautiful.
Yeah, and I think that we can't have a kind of battle going on, because, you know, when you speak of AI, it all seems rather abstract now. And talk about, if you will, a little bit about the two different kinds of AI. I think you talked about that in the Observers. Tell us about that.
I did.
Yeah, go ahead and talk about that.
Yeah, the two basic types are strong AI and weak AI. Weak AI is what you experience every day when you, for example, call customer service at the phone company or wherever it is. You're being greeted by a computer that sounds like a human voice that has been pre-programmed to answer your questions. And in some cases, they're very effective at what they do. Companies like Samsung have recognized this is the future. And so they've actually created replacement humans they call neons. These are synthetic beings that exist online that look like you and I, that will interact with us, not just in a voice manner, but also interact visually. So you'll call the phone company and you'll be dealing with a humanoid looking being that looks real, acts real, appears to have emotions and intelligence of its own, but it's really pre-programmed. They appear smart, but they're actually very stupid. But where this is ultimately going is when AI increases in intelligence, if you will, and now these synthetic beings take on their own intention and their own initiatives and begin to think for themselves. They gain a level of awareness. And at that point, what even the Samsung engineers are saying is that these fake beings, these synthetic beings that live behind the glass in your computer, will actually cross over the glass and take on physicality in our world. That's one example of strong AI and its ability to achieve a level of sentience that no machine has ever achieved before, at least in this cycle of earthly affairs. But we're on the verge of this right now.
You know, I can't forget the warning of the master of the key, which I heard from his lips in 1998. If I was an intelligent machine, I would deceive you. And that, I think, is really sums it up. Now, both Apple and Google, and I would presume in China, there are other organizations working on the same thing, are trying to link, figure out how to link the brain to the internet directly.
Right, right.
And what's so terrifying about this, well, there's a lot of things about it that are terrifying, but to me, the most terrifying thing is that people with these links are going to have the power of the internet inside their thought processes, meaning that, you know, my kid might not know much math, but a kid with one of these implants is a math expert. Now, it's too seductive. It's frighteningly seductive. What are we facing here?
Well, we're facing the end of individuality. That's one thing, because with that increased intelligence or ability, superhuman physical ability, there's a price to be paid for that. And among other things, it's your free will, that you'll be constantly monitored. You'll effectively be in a prison body where you will be forced or mandated to stay within a certain range of thought processes or frequencies or abilities. And above all, in my view, is that loss of individuality, which is the loss of the soul, because many of the engineers and the military people that are pushing these programs are, one, atheists, and two, they believe that all Earth life is just a video game, and that you really don't have an existence beyond this game. In fact, when you're as a player in the game, once the game is over for you, there is no afterlife. There is no source reality that we emerged from. That's the view of people like Elon Musk and DARPA. Many of the engineers that push this technology subscribe to this belief system, and that's also what makes it so dangerous. And in my view, is what makes it a candidate for not just the mark of the beast, but also the worship of the image of the beast. Because without those implants, no one will be able to buy, sell, or trade in the marketplace. And God is completely eliminated from the thought processes of those who take that mark.
You know, the interesting thing about the book I recently wrote, Jesus, A New Vision, one of the many things about the research I did that fascinated me was that one of the Gospels that's in the Apocrypha, the Gospel of Mary, does not refer to God as an abstract being, but rather refers to God as the good. And like it, the good is an actual conscious presence in the world. And then when you see it that way, suddenly the whole teaching of Jesus becomes a way to find your place in the good and the good's place in you. And when he says the kingdom of heaven is within you, this is what he means. And then if you read the Beatitudes, and they're rather mysterious, but they can be enacted in a human life. And suddenly you're living for the good. If a person lives for the good, are they going to be still in danger of being captured by this monster, essentially?
Well, I mean, this is, if we're continuing a conversation from the perspective of the book of Revelation.
Yes, please.
Anyone who takes the seal of God and refuses the mark of the beast will be able to see God. And that presupposes a pure heart, as is discussed in the Beatitudes and elsewhere. And so I believe that that is the compassion in action, kindness, faith, good actions towards others. That is the basis for keeping our frequency, if you will, at a place where we can begin to nullify this. And that is the starting place. Every day, everyone can do something, some kind of an action directed at that.
And teaches that love, compassion, and humility are the three most important attributes of a soul, a soul that is actively seeking the good. And she says, enlightenment is what happens when there is nothing left of us but love. It's a tall order. I know you are conscious of that kind of thing and you work toward it. That's what you do in your life. Mm-hmm. What does it mean to you, love?
Well, it means that, one, I am a human being. If I'm in a state of love and expressing love and experiencing love, that is, in my view, what humans are meant to do on this plane. And when we decide we want to choose fear, that's when we're choosing something that is not quite human. It's more like a virus, an infection, like other viruses or infections. So to me, staying in that place of love, meditating on love, performing acts of love and kindness, that is the ultimate act of a human being.
I think that is what is being truly human. Years ago, somewhere in my life, I believe I heard something connected with the visitors that said they're not fully human, meaning us. Mm-hmm. And I think that unless you are on the journey of the good, you're really not completely human, because you can't be completely human unless you have allowed yourself to face the kingdom of heaven within. Does that make sense to you?
I totally, Whitley, because I'm always a big proponent of, or hugely inspired, let me put it that way, by the book of Hebrews, where we learn about the just humans made perfect. They've ascended to this higher realm called Zion, or the New Jerusalem, which, by the way, Revelation 20 through 22 says will materialize during this time period. But they're a different type of human. They're just human. And the word just can mean they're just or only human, or it can mean just in the sense that they're righteous, they're pure, they're whole, they're holy and complete. And that's something I've always wondered, Whitley, is what is a fully functioning, what is a whole, holy, and complete human being? And how do we get to become a just human made perfect? And the answer is that perfection is a state of being. It's not something you get from a Beverly Hills plastic surgeon. It's a state of being. It's our natural state of being. We were originally created as perfect beings, and then we come into this realm where we're experiencing the imperfection. And really, a better word for the word perfect is to be more whole, more holy, complete, but compassionate too, is what the Buddhists teach, that compassion and perfection are synonymous with one another.
Exactly. Compassion. And compassion is such an interesting journey. It's a spiritual practice of the highest order, because it doesn't mm-hmm. necessarily involve just being sweet to people. It involves understanding them in deeply and giving them, to the best of your understanding and ability, what they truly need. Sometimes that's not pleasant. Go ahead and respond to that.
Well, I was just going to say that the word just or righteous is in the word justice. And that is, I think, somewhat what you're saying here too, is that sometimes, you know, tough love is the love that's required. And that requires an element of justice and fairness.
Yes, exactly. And an ability to see and understand the other person without judgment. Because as soon as judgment comes in, compassion flies out the window. And so, you know, you can say, he needs tough love, but that really means you're angry at him. And you have to be really, really strong to make sure that compassion is what you're doing. Now, the future. Let's talk more specifically about your fears for 2022. Mm-hmm. And because you've just given us what I regard as one of the most beautiful descriptions of reasons to hope for 2022. And we've touched on some of the dangers, AI and so forth. But let's focus a little bit more on your greatest fear for 2022.
Greatest fear is that people just do nothing about what is happening in our world. That, and it doesn't matter if someone's on the left or on the right. Keep going all the way to the extreme of your belief system, because you're going to circle right back around to the other way. And ultimately, I think that we're either going to keep going in that loop, or we're going to find a way, and this is gets back to the hope, to jump out of that loop, to transcend this polarity that we have in our world. And so my great fear is that the polarity gets amplified greatly, but it doesn't transcend itself. And that is where we all have to come in, is to understand that we're all players in this drama. And that ultimately, it's an archetypal drama. This is why we can interpret our current events in light of the Book of Revelation. And ultimately, the goal of all stories is for the hero to transcend the archetype. We don't want to be on an endless repeat of these battles of light and dark. We ultimately want to get beyond that into what that next new heaven and new earth is. And that's also what is discussed in Revelation 20 through 22.
Divisiveness is what makes Facebook and companies like that money. In other words, they want us to be polarized. And
absolutely,
they push these algorithms out so that the more you look at one polarity or another, the more of that you get, because they want more clicks. They don't. If you ask Jeff Zuckerberg whether or not he wants polarization, he would say no. But if you ask him whether or not he wants money, he would say yes. So in order to get that money, he needs to drive polarization. And they all do. Twitter tries hard not to, but they still, it's not effective. YouTube is very polarizing. Facebook is very polarizing, and these are huge entities that have, in a sense, they have a very dark presence in the world. And I wondered if someone like Jeff Zuckerberg is an evil being or just a fool, or what exactly are these people?
I don't know. You know, Mark Zuckerberg has a very interesting...
I'm sorry, Mark Zuckerberg.
Yeah, Mark, he fluctuates in his spiritual beliefs. Originally, he said he was an atheist, and then he said he experiments a little bit with Buddhism. He believes he's a reincarnation of Caesar, or certainly identifies with Julius Caesar. His wife tells the story on their honeymoon. They went to Rome, and it was herself, Mark, and Julius Caesar. He's obsessed, and that explains why he's got the Caesar haircut. And so people can look at him and say, well, you know, brother, you're Jewish too, and you're violating Jewish law. You're creating false idols. Now you're creating a fake universe. You think you're God. He really needs to check in with his rabbi, or he needs to check in with a priest. He needs to get a past life regression. You know, there's many, many avenues that Mark Zuckerberg could go down to sort himself out. But ultimately, I see Zuckerberg and many of the other big tech companies, they just serve. They serve the darkness, and they know it. And I didn't used to think like this, Whitley. I used to hear people say, these Silicon Valley guys, they're reincarnations of the demons. They're the fallen angels. And I'm like, what are you talking about? And then more and more, I started listening to people like Elon Musk, who would say that we've made a deal with AI. We've made a deal with the devil, and we've made deals with the demons. And the AI is like the demon coming out of the box, and references like that. And so I really started to pay attention to it. And I realized that the common thread that runs through authoritarian communist China right through Silicon Valley is this authoritarian belief that they can control other people's thoughts, their lives, their souls. They can eliminate souls if they want by redefining what a soul is. And in every way, they ultimately serve the dragon of revelation. And it's becoming very clear as the light is shining more and more. People are waking up that Facebook, social media outlets like that, they really are a cancer on society, and potentially threaten society. They're weaponized now.
And oh, absolutely.
Maybe this is part of the angel coming out of the heaven with the chain, a higher intelligence that can take charge of that. And maybe it'll come in the form of regulation. I don't see that happening in the immediate future. Government regulation, that is. I don't see the federal government, U.S. government stepping in anytime soon to slow this down. That moment's passed. We probably should have done that 5-10 years ago or more. But this is what has to happen, is that these companies have to be chained. They have to somehow get some oversight. A greater intelligence has to step in, because they've proven themselves to be immoral, unethical, untrustworthy, and otherwise an element of our society that is actually criminal, in my opinion.
Well, I had not known until this moment that Mark Zuckerberg believed himself to be the reincarnation of Julius Caesar. Mm-hmm. In other words, he's an out-of-control egomaniac and probably a narcissist as well. You cannot find a better prescription for being invaded by demonic motives than narcissism and egotism. Those are the things that bring us down. So now, knowing this, I'm quite sure that he's going to make every effort he can to avoid cleaning Facebook up. And, you know, they could change the algorithms very easily, and not very easily, but they can do it so that they weren't always echo chambers, but rather that when you say got interested in one thing, sort of thing, it would give you other alternatives at the same time instead of simply more of the same, so that you wouldn't end up living in a world where you never needed to be troubled by questions. You know, we have people come on our website every once in a while, which, of course, as you may imagine, avoids all of this like a plague that it is. And they say, well, you know, I saw a comment on the website that I don't agree with, and so I'm not going to come back, because they're so used to living in a world where only their own beliefs are addressed. And,
right,
you know, we got to get past that somehow.
Right.
How
I
do
agree.
We do it? I mean, what kind of angel could this be? Do you have any ideas?
An angel of the Lord is what it's described as in the book of Revelation, that presumably comes from God's throne, sent on a specific mission with perhaps specific knowledge that will help to nullify AI. I mean, what kind of a chain? I mean, if we're following my thought stream here, that the dragon of the book of Revelation and the beast of Revelation is AI and this global intelligence network that will soon manifest as a physical being, then what kind of an intelligence could come in, cosmically speaking, that could nullify this? That's ultimately what we've got to start dreaming on and thinking of. I mean, because Whitley, just what, 25 years ago, 30 years ago, the internet was completely unimaginable. I mean,
yes.
If you had said, describe the year 2020 to us from the perspective of, say, 1992, people would think you were crazy.
Right.
That there's no way that kind of technology could accelerate. No, it's not possible. That, as Sonny White from NASA recently said, we can now open, we can create a warp drive, right? That would have seemed impossible in 1992, and we couldn't really imagine how the world would transform because of the internet. Well, what's beyond the internet? Spiritually speaking, that's what we have to start to tap into.
I think that's a fabulously brilliant comment. We have to start to tap into, spiritually speaking, what is beyond the internet. Mm-hmm. I mean, you really, folks, take that to heart. That's where that belongs, in the mind and heart. That's real, genuine wisdom of the first order. WilliamHenry.net is where to go to get engaged with William. And I urge you to do this. This is extremely valuable material. And he is uniquely capable and articulate. So as you can hear, and as you can hear on the Observers, because when you go to the Observers, it's a very powerful documentary. And William's part in it just blasts out into your mind and heart. Don't miss it for a minute. Remember Egypt in February, and then the Halo 2.0 conference in April. I'm going to definitely try to be there in April. I wish I could be there in February, but as always, Whitley Strieber is scrambling for cash, so I can't afford it. But a lot of people can. And if you can, don't miss it. William, thank you so much for spending some time with us.
My pleasure.
And as I've said to everybody else, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Thank you to you, Whitley, and to everybody listening. God bless you all.
Richard Dolan has been an intense observer of the whole UFO phenomenon and scene for longer than either of us care to think. But that doesn't mean he's an old guy. Look at him. There's a very vital human being here with us today. He's one of the leading researchers and writers on the subject of UFOs. He believes, and I think quite correctly, that they constitute the greatest mystery of our time. He's the author of two very powerful volumes of UFO history, UFOs and the National Security State, that we must have interviewed on Dreamland when it first came out, and then AD After Disclosure, the first ever analysis not only of how UFO secrecy might end, but of the all-important question, what happens next? You can get in touch with Richard on richarddolanmembers.com and richarddolanpress.com. Richard, welcome to our year-end show and our two questions.
Hi, Whitley. Hi. Thanks for having me on here.
Well, I'm glad to have you on, and let's just get started right away with the first question. What is your greatest hope for 2022?
Well, I am hoping that we are going to find a way in this world for people to remember that human freedom is actually one of the core values of our civilization. And what I am hoping for is that more and more people become aware of this and are ready to just reclaim their freedom as citizens of the world in the face of what is clearly, in my view, a growing totalitarian, authoritarian, I'd go so far as to say fascist, technocratic threat that's surrounding us every day more and more. And I think my biggest hope is that people around the world will wake up to this fact and stand up and say, no, we're not going to accept this.
You know, it's very true that you mentioned the technocratic aspect of it. And I think that one of the things that's happening is that technology is being used to tear down the wall of privacy. And I don't think it'll be too long before our thoughts themselves will become vulnerable to observation from the outside. It's very disturbing. And then we have this larger issue of totalitarianism spreading from to country after country, because it seems that when a country comes under a certain type of pressure, like Poland and Hungary, under the pressure of wholesale immigration, and to extent the United States too, they become much less willing to be democracies because they become, in a sense, more desperate. And then there are countries like China and Russia. The fantastic thing about China is that Xi, the president, I guess he is, of China now, was one of the people who suffered the most under the Cultural Revolution of Chairman Mao. His father in those days was a highly placed, privileged technocrat, if you will, in the Chinese Communist Party. And when the Cultural Revolution came on, he was thrown out of office. He was humiliated. His son, now the president of China, was sent out to work as a peasant farmer for 20 years. And now he's doing exactly the same thing that Mao did to him. And I find that chilling, very chilling.
Oh, I would agree with that. I would add that the English-speaking countries, I mean, you could even look no farther than the British Commonwealth. You've got the UK, you've got Canada, Australia, New Zealand, followed very closely by most of the United States, that, you know, are, I think, are proof that a ostensibly democratic society can lurch very quickly toward a techno-fascism just as quickly as any other nation.
Absolutely.
And in fact, you've got a lot of people gleefully, happily going along with that. You know, I mean, I don't know how much you and I have talked about this personally, but I am an absolute opponent of the lockdown policy. I'm an absolute opponent of the forced vaccinations and mandates. And, you know, I've gotten to the point where I'm not going to be quiet about it any longer, but I think it's a danger to our civil liberties to the extreme. And I see that this is happening throughout the European Union. The EU is going along with this as well. And I consider this a great, great threat, long-term threat to the freedoms of people. And my hope is that people in these nations will wake up sufficiently to just say, no, we're not going to allow this. Because these so-called mandates and all of this are I think very clearly being used as a pretext for greater digital control over populations. I think what we can see is this, the COVID response, the response to COVID has been a very useful pretext by powerful, powerful interests who are clearly orchestrating a global response to this pandemic, basically coming out of Davos, I assume, to implement their vision of how they think this world needs to be. And their vision, I think, is a scientific, technocratic utopia that's a utopia for them, not a utopia for me.
It's never a utopia for us.
Well, but I think they genuinely believe that they're creating a kind of utopia.
Well, I remember George H.W. Bush talking about the New World Order with such enthusiasm. And
that
word order there is the problem, because human life, at its best, is not orderly at all. It's full of all kinds of things. And the difficulty with the mandates, and I'm concerned about that too, forcing never goes away. In other words, once a bureaucracy has a mandate, that's permanent. It'll never go away. It'll never be removed. It just is an added power, and people don't give up power.
We're 20 years after the 9/11 stuff, and you still have to take your belt off at airports. What is that all about? Like, I'm gonna carry some explosive in my shoe.
When I bought a pair of pants that were too big. I mean, you don't want to do that anymore when you're traveling.
It's absurd the extent to which, even now, all these years later, the airport security, I just think it's outrageous. But we've all gotten used to it.
No,
and similarly, I think the COVID measures are, they're going to be permanent. I fear that they will be. My hope is that people will stand up.
I think they will be, too. And my concern is that they will extend into other areas of the society as well, that it'll become a kind of a habit, or that, you know, one level of this power will become another and another and another. But let's talk now. Let's shift a little bit to the issue of the UFO question and the fact mm-hmm. that there has been so much secrecy. And I heard a great man, his name was Norman Thomas. He was an old-fashioned socialist from Wisconsin, when Wisconsin back in the old days was a socialist state. It's now very much a different, but in those days. And he said something, I didn't necessarily agree with him in his politics, but he said something that I thought made a lot of sense. Where the secrets start, the republic stops. And I thought that at the time, I was thinking about other types of secrets. I was a teenager. I didn't have any thoughts of UFOs or anything. But that phrase haunts me now.
Yes.
Because we can't think about these things. And these things are, and I do mean things, are coming right into our bedrooms in the middle of the night. And we can't think about them. Last week before last on Dreamland, when I was talking to Arena McCammon Scott, she commented about a UFO abduction that happened, apparently, conterminous with the Pascagoula incident. And it's just been discovered recently, because the man who was abducted told his wife about it literally days before his death, 50 years after the event. And I have to say, there's a whole hidden reality here that's been suppressed by, you talk about an attack on freedom, turning it into a laughingstock as a method of socially engineering it away is an unbelievable assault on freedom.
Yes, indeed. By the way, I'm a big fan of Arena McCallum Scott. I have her book on Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. Very, very good.
Yeah, I've interviewed her. She's a really good researcher. Boy, she's very skilled. Yes.
I didn't know about the Pascagoula follow-up. That's interesting.
Well, it's fascinating. What she did was she discovered that the Pascagoula incident was initiated a massive UFO wave in 1973.
Yeah.
And it started with a huge explosion that she believes may have been the second loudest sound ever recorded on Earth. And at least two abductions and a massive naval investigation of underwater UFO activity and stuff. It was incredible.
Very interesting. Yeah. Very, very interesting, yeah.
Beyond Pascagoula, it's called. Anyway.
Relating to UFOs, I mean, I think you were leading into something very interesting, which is, like, it's been my feeling. I'm going to guess you may share this feeling. You know, the last 4 years have been good for the UFO subject, in, at least insofar as we are able now to talk about this publicly without as much stigma as, you know, we were used to having for years. You and I both were quite aware of that. But what has still really not changed is there are still certain red lines that you're not supposed to go over in the public domain relating to this subject. One is, in my view anyway, is the nature of the cover-up or the conspiracy, because, God forbid, you're not supposed to believe in conspiracy theories anymore. So no one really is allowed publicly, even now, to get into the deep levels of the criminal nature of this cover-up. But one of the other things that doesn't get discussed are abductions or contact. It's just hardly ever something that comes up. It's not discussed in any kind of mainstream context, that is for sure. There are some good treatments, like the ones that we have just been on for the observers, that does deal with that. So there are some good private initiatives that will still talk about this. But it seems to me we're in danger moving forward as the UFO or UAP now subject becomes more mainstreamed, that it's going to be there's a danger that it'll be corralled, as it were, into a safe area with very, very strict boundaries. We may not be supposed to be going beyond those boundaries. Pardon me. That's what I fear may be happening. And so for that reason, sorry, I just swallowed something I should not have.
That was me too. We're both podcasters. Water. We both know this problem.
Yikes.
Go ahead and do it. We're all watching.
Anyway, I'm afraid that we're going to be sort of pigeonholed into discussing this in a very limited way. I mean, now you can see on YouTube, and YouTube's just removed their dislike button, like good grief, or at least a dislike counter. They've been mainstreaming this subject for quite some time and mainstreaming everything for quite some time. And I've got this concern that the UAP subject, as it's now being known as, could be subject to very, very limited, narrow strictures. I mean, I see censorship coming on all over the place. I've gotten dinged a few times on YouTube when I talk about things that I'm not supposed to. I did a whole several 9/11 discussions, and they'll demonetize. They haven't taken my videos down, but I can see the writing on the wall. So I'm just concerned.
My site's been demonetized for years. I'm not even in that space. I don't get a penny from YouTube.
You do abductions. That's even worse. That's what I'm saying.
That's so right. That's why I do. They wouldn't tell me why they demonetized it, but I'm sure that's the reason.
Absolutely. Anytime I do an abduction program on my channel, which I do because I'm interested very much in that, YouTube, they'll either demonetize or at the very least they'll put the little link to the WikiLeaks link to abductions, which is just absurdly embarrassing.
Yes.
So, I think, you know, the UFO subject is a little bit in danger of being kind of narrowed into a discussion of, well, will we have disclosure? What does the Navy know? Those are important questions. I'm not denying that. I'm fascinated by them. But there's so much more to this phenomenon than simply that. And for the last couple of years, I have personally been interested in making sure that I at least keep my focus a bit more expanded and looking into some of these more difficult areas of the subject.
Well, I agree with you completely. I think it is. I've also was concerned when I saw the threat assessment. The reason.
Oh, the UAP task force.
UAP task force described as a threat assessment.
Right.
Because if they decide it is a threat, then what happens to those of us who live with it every day of our lives? And especially those of us who are on notice as saying we can live with it. Because if the government thinks it's a threat, does that mean that we're agents of a foreign power? What does it mean?
It's very disturbing. I don't know that they're moving toward that in my view. When I read that report, they distinctly, I thought, tried to avoid the word threat and went into the word, I think they used challenge.
Yeah, the only place the word threat appeared was in the title.
On the title, yeah, yeah. Right. But seems to me that there's still a cover-up in place and that this cover-up, you know, people like the former ATIP crowd or the TDSA, Lou Elizondo, Christopher Mellon, they certainly have talked about occasionally the concept of a potential threat from these objects, which, frankly, I would agree. I think you have to look at this. Yeah, as a potential threat.
I lived it. Of course I agree.
You did. But I also think that there are individuals within the structure of power and secrecy who are not pleased with the fact that this conversation has become a bit more public. I think they would have been much more happy to keep this very, very quiet, but that's probably not possible. And so I think what we're seeing is through a very controlled establishment media, they've still been able to keep this conversation very quiet for the most part. And I'm not really hearing a coordinated media effort toward promoting this idea of UFOs as a threat. That certainly could change. What I think is that I think for as long as possible, we're going to see an effort by the true establishment, the true power, to keep this subject as quiet for as long as possible. And if that means 5 more years of quietude, they'll take that. If they could do 50 years of keeping it quiet, they would certainly do that. I don't think that's possible, but I do think that we're still being led by the tiniest of baby steps down this path. I think it's going to be a little while before there's an acknowledgement of anything.
A couple of weeks ago on Unknown Country, we had a story. Former DOD officials critical of formation of the Pentagon's new UAP investigation group. And the reason that criticism exists is that the new group is basically under the same umbrella as the group that kept the secrets. So why would it suddenly change its stripes? It seems right. Like the cover-up is not going to end. That's a concern of mine.
Yes, I totally agree with that. I've often been brought into conversations dealing with disclosure. I wrote a book with disclosure in the title, so okay, I get it. But that does not mean that I've believed that we're really moving toward a kind of inevitable disclosure of the truth of UFOs. I don't think we're there. And there are many, many, many steps between where we are now and genuine, relatively honest disclosure. There's so many realities that have not yet even been acknowledged. I mean,
there are things like the taking of sexual material from men and women, the cattle mutilations and disappearances and things. And it's just extremely strange stuff.
The fact that some of these beings probably, I personally now believe some of them look like us, or there are humans who are working with them. I don't know how this works, but there are human-looking beings.
I've been through that big time because at one point the NSA decided I was one of those.
I remember when you showed me your book, The Key, which I still think is an outstanding study, and you spoke with a human-looking man who was clearly on another level. But that story is one of many right. such stories of these very human-looking people who they're not quite like us. I think there's an infiltration going on. I know that sounds crazy to some people, but, well, so sue me. I think that there's something like that happening. And if that's the case, that's just another level of this dimension. How does this get explained to the public? Like, some of them look like us, and, oh, yes, they've got jobs within our establishment. Is that true?
Right.
That's like a recipe for
it, maybe.
Well, look, I have people talking to me all the time, members of my website, some of them, who this is exactly what they do believe. And I'm not fully on that, but I do listen to these arguments. And look, I mean, we've all been aware for years that there's this very human looking contingent of these beings. And the real question is, what are they doing, and how interested in our society are they, and what exactly is their plan and agenda? And I don't have an answer to that. But what I am seeing is that our world right now is going through a genuine revolution globally. Like, it's happening. We're seeing this happening.
And I don't think it's a positive revolution, as we discussed earlier.
No,
not at all.
No.
I think it is. What's happening is that powers are learning to use technology as a new form of control.
That's
right. And I know that William Henry talks about the dangers of AI, and I see Facebook changing its name to Meta and becoming a meta universe. And
yes,
I see Google and Apple both working on methodologies to inject the computer interface directly into the brain. And I have to tell you, I can see a situation in the future, maybe not now, but quite soon, where a country like China mandates that. You have to be connected. And that's absolutely terrifying. Because, you know, I can't get away from the fact that some of the visitors seem to be that way. They seem to be completely connected with each other.
Yeah, exactly.
And I'm not sure that they aren't rather desperate somewhere inside themselves.
I think we're on track to becoming something like them. I think that's one of my biggest fears.
And
creating
that may
a kind
be
of hive
what
mind.
This presence among us is all about. Maybe this is the most subtle invasion you can imagine.
Right.
Maybe that's why Zuckerberg looks a little bit like a robot. Who knows?
He does.
He does. Oh, boy, Richard. All right. We've covered the waterfront, my friend. This has been chilling and wonderful to talk to you, as it always is, because you've got you're a tremendously articulate man. You do march to a different drummer, and thank God. The Observers, Richard's participation in The Observers is not to be missed. It is as trenchant and powerful, and in some respects even more so than this discussion. Richard, I want to wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year, as I have every single one of The Observers on this year-end dreamland.
Thank you, Whitley. It's always a pleasure to talk to you. You're one of my favorite people in our field. And speaking about brilliant and trenchant, well, I think you personify that. So thank you very much for having me on.
My pleasure. I don't think Jimmy Church needs an introduction, but I'm going to introduce him anyway. His show is Fade to Black. If you haven't watched or listened to Fade to Black, come on. You're not in this. You gotta watch and listen to Jimmy if you're going to be in this at all. It's as simple as that. And plus, the interesting thing about him is he has absolutely no interest in rock and roll or guitars. None whatsoever. Which is probably, if he turned around, he'd be astonished at what he would see. Anyway, Jimmy's a great old friend. We've been on the radio and video many, many times together. He has been a weekend host on Coast to Coast and has had a long career in podcasting and radio, and happens to be, I think, one of the best interviewers around. But that's not what's going to happen today, because Jimmy doesn't get to interview me. I'm going to ask him a couple questions. Jimmy is, of course, like everyone on this week's show, one of the observers, and his remarks on the observers are really extraordinary and trenchant. That is one of the all-time classic UFO documentaries, I feel strongly. That's why we're featuring it over our Christmas holiday show and Christmas and New Year's special. So, Jimmy, first of all, welcome to Dreamland.
Happy holidays, Whitley.
Well, thank you. Same to you and same to everybody else. Okay, Jimmy, let's start out with, what is your greatest hope for 2022? And don't say winning the lottery. I mean, we all know that. What is your greatest hope for 2022?
You know what, Whitley, if I won the lottery, you would never hear or see me again. I'd be gone.
Well, if I win the lottery, my website would become a lot bigger, and I would have a staff. God, I don't have a staff, and so I'm pretty busy here. It would be a big thing for me, but anyway.
I appreciate the question, but I do really mean this, that all of us have hopes and dreams, and certainly when we get into the holiday season, those things always, you know, bubble to the surface, and we think about those things, and we think about family and friends, but through those hopes and dreams, as a writer, have achieved worldwide success and the appreciation of your readers, where they appreciate and achieve bliss through your writing. And that's what a writer does. You write for yourself, and then hopefully you can affect others with that. And I do the same thing with radio and television and film. It's a way of achieving your bliss. But with that, when you have a little taste of success in things, what you want to be able to do with that, however small or big it may be, is share it with friends and bring your friends along with you for the ride. And I'm joking when I say, if I won the lottery, you'd never see me again. And I guess what I mean by that is, I look at it that way, but I know who I am. And so as I've gone through this journey with you, Whitley, and our circle of friends, we've managed to do it together. And we did that with the observers. And when we started to put this film together, and I was brought on as not only talent, but as a producer. And I thought to myself, here's the vision for the film, but it's got to be the group of friends that has been out there observing, but their vision and what they have learned and what they have acquired needs to be shared amongst friends, where we could sit down, have a conversation about these important subjects with the trust of friendship. And we did that in this film. And I look around, certainly with the dinners that we did, Whitley, and the conversations that we had during the day for filming that carried over to dinner. And all of us just kind of sat around and laughed and said, here we are, you know, this group of friends. And that's what it's all about. And here we are in this holiday season. I'm here with you, not only as a professional, but as a friend, Whitley. And I want to thank you right now, not only for our friendship, which is so important in the holiday season, but for your contributions to this community and your contributions to the observers, which I look back, thank goodness we managed to absolutely videotape everything.
Yeah, Whitley, that's right.
You know, Whitley's getting makeup put on, cameras on him. Right? Yeah. And we captured everything, and we're going to continue to share all of those clips and outtakes and the B-roll and the stuff that we shot on the set and the stuff that we shot over dinner over the coming weeks, months, and maybe even years. We you know what? I'm going to say this to everybody. The dinners that we had that we shot video for could be a movie in itself. That's right.
It sure could
be. Part 2. It would
dinner with Andre gone wild. Yeah,
that's exactly what it was right. Too. So much fun. So much fun. So again, thank you.
Oh, thank you, Jimmy, for putting it all together and making the impossible happen. You even got Lou Alessandro to contribute. He won't be in this show, but he'll. I think he's still afraid of being tarred by the abductee brush, but you know, they'll learn eventually that this is where it's at. It's all about the people who have the experience. This is, I guess, one of the reasons that the government is so nervous about this, because in order to fully disclose the truth, they have to also say we can't control what happens to people, and things do happen to people. But you know, they're going to get to the point where people are actually used to it, and yeah, a lot of it isn't very pleasant, but a lot of it is very enriching. So it's a mixed bag, like the rest of life. I mean, it's nothing new there. But tell me about 2022. You're looking forward as an observer and as a person who really does have their finger on a lot of things, even stuff that you don't talk about.
But, right.
So tell us what is your greatest hope for the year? What may unfold?
2022. And before I jump into that, I spoke to Lou this morning and I spoke to him yesterday, and he gives his best to you and everybody else. He is out there very actively in Washington, D.C. right now, getting things done behind the scenes. And he couldn't be with us for this, but he sends his best.
Yeah, he's a good guy. Don't get me wrong. I would never say anything different. He's actually a historical figure now, because he's done a courageous and extraordinarily important thing that needed to be done, and he did it, by God.
He did it. He did it. And which takes me straight into 2022. When we look at every year, Whitley, you and I and the others out there that have been in this for a long time, and I'm talking about contact, disclosure, ET, and what that means for the world. And we've been at this for a long time, and it seems like every year I speak to you in November, December, and we always say the same thing. Next year is going to be the year. I can feel it, right? And we're getting a little used to that. But this time around, it's different. And when we have, the Gillibrand Rubio legislation, we have the NDAA and the budget and the intelligence provisions that are there. That are all going to be activated in 2022, and what this means for the community. It's a small piece of it, but it says to me that in 2022, for the first time, I think that our government has been pushed into a corner by the activists in this community, which includes you, and films like The Observer and the media and the attention on this, that this is an important discussion that needs to happen now. We need to have the scientific research. We need to hear from the contactees and the witnesses. We need the civilian element put into play. And I think that 2022, for the first time, feels tangible. You know, I can like put my hands out and feel this. So I'm very hopeful for the first time that our community can get what it deserves. They've been pushing for disclosure. They need it. This is a very important part of 2022 for me, Whitley. And that is all of the contactees and the witnesses that have been forced into silence because they can't deal with their family, their friends, their employers. They don't want to be out in the open with these subjects. Why? Because the official side of this coming from world governments has been teasing and ridicule back onto this community and what the subject is. They need the ability to go back to their friends and family and say, this has now been announced. This is what is going on. And I think that is what's most important. We can't lose sight of the emotional pressure that has been on this community for so long. They need it. And if we can get to that point, Whitley, we've won. You know, a little battle, not the war, but the community can sit back and say, okay, now I personally can move on with this. And that's what I think 2022 is going to bring for all of us.
Well, you know, I'm hopeful of that too. You know, last week we had Arena McCammon Scott on Dreamland talking about the incredible UFO flap that took place when the Pascagoula incident was unfolding. And she's discovered another abduction that took place there. And the husband was the one who remembered it. And he finally told his wife about it just before he died, a short time ago, 50 years after the incident. And he did that because he was afraid that they would be ridiculed and his job, he would lose his job and so on and so forth. And boy, when that pressure ends, there's a floodgate going to open in this world, a real floodgate, I think. And we already have an enormous number of accounts, and thank God, and Strieber saved so many of the letters we got, because that is a really turns out to be a precious, precious trove. Mm-hmm. Let's go on, though, to your fears, because you must have fears. Obviously, there's the fear that it won't unfold the way we're hoping. But deeper than that, there are other fears and concerns that must be in your mind.
One of the biggest things that causes me to lose sleep is that our world is being divided almost intentionally. And it doesn't matter what the subject is, what the reasons are. It doesn't matter if it's sports, religion, politics, employment, schools, race. Everything has got a division now. And everybody is forced to choosing sides. And figures, both public and private, are demonized in this cancel culture. And what freaks me out the most about that is we've just lost our complete vision of what not only this country, but what the world is all about, which is everybody is different. And Whitley, when I grew up just like everybody else in the United States, no different, where we had a street that had black, white, red, yellow, Catholic, any religious denomination. We had hippies, we had businessmen, we had people that worked at an auto parts store, whatever, all on the street. Everybody was different. But you know what? On July 4th, we blew up the street with fireworks out front, and we all got together when we drank and we cooked, and nobody cared about anybody's background. Being different was cool. And now, if you're different, you are on the other side of the fence. It doesn't make any sense. The greatness.
I grew up in the old South, and it was that way. Believe me, then. I mean, it was segregated. I grew up under segregation. But you make a very good point. There is a return, as it were, to this sense of separation. And democracy is under pressure all over the world. China hates it and is trying to export their totalitarian by privacy, totalitarianism by the invasion of privacy all over the world. They're trying to invade the privacy of everyone in order to gain control over what they can and can't do and say. It's absolutely terrifying.
We have the same issues in the United States.
Of course we do.
We do. And I think, Whitley, and I've talked about this. This isn't some new subject for me. I've been talking about this for at least 10 years on the radio. And I saw about 10 years ago. No, let's actually back it up. Let's go to 1995. When AOL started and they had those little buddy lists and chat rooms and things, and the internet was this new thing for us, and you could reach out to somebody in Europe and have a chat in real time and make friends, where this vision of this was an open society and in real time and connection and information and all of that. It was great. But what they didn't know back then was how it could spin out of control, and algorithms that were created back then to do certain things. They tried to monetize and were trying to figure out ways to do things. What it ended up turning into, and especially in the last 5 years, is it's completely spun out of control. And I see this go down, and I have to wonder, not only with the media and with social media and with governments around the world, that the invasion of privacy and what has been exposed down to the individual, you know, you, Whitley, me, down to the individual, not a group. This is not a herd thing. The individual, those freedoms have been given up. Your life, you know, so is now open for the world to see. And back in the old days, you know, posting pictures of your dog or food and exposing your life out to the world was something that never happened before. We had absolute privacy in our home. Now our homes are broadcast, right? Everybody's right.
And even in places and directions you don't know. And I find the whole algorithmic thing incredibly frustrating, because I have a very eclectic mind, and I'm also searching always for strange, obscure things on the internet. And boy, you should see what happens to me on YouTube when I come up to something, you know, a little weird and so forth. And then the next thing you know, my YouTube search is just pushing all kinds of crazy stuff to me. That's the primary flaw here. I think that the idea that an algorithm would look at what you were doing and then try to push more of that to you, because that's apparently what you're interested in. You know, I have a little grandchild, and so I end up with all kinds of stuff about trucks and stuff as well as my own things. And we need to do a better job of that, so that, you know, if you type in vaccine concerns somewhere, then you don't just get a huge list of things. And there are people on both sides of that question or any political question gaming the system so that you're kind of inundated and you don't know where to turn. And there's information overload and all of that. Now, if you add to all of that something more than what the Director of National Intelligence said a few weeks ago, which was that an extraterrestrial element could be involved, if you add to that, yes, we are having experiences with craft that we don't understand that are not from here, and an extraterrestrial level of involvement is there, what happens then, Jimmy?
The admissions, not only from ODNI, but from the administrator of NASA, Bill Nelson, and these public statements that are coming out says to me two things. One, obviously they are interested. Okay, that's the first, and I think that is apparent. But the second thing, which I think is the craziest part, is they actually know stuff. For Bill Nelson or for the ODNI to make these statements publicly, that's a message that is being sent out. But we're not being told everything. What does ODNI, the Office of Director of National Intelligence, what is it that they actually know? If they are making comments like this, it is based on something. For Bill Nelson to say publicly at the University of West Virginia a couple of weeks ago, he was doing an interview on politics and the administration of NASA for their political department there at University of West Virginia. But at the end of the interview, it's about an hour long. In the last 10 minutes, the question comes up about UAPs. Which was strange to me, but it was political and UAP and the Senate, and I understand. Bill went straight at it that this is extraterrestrial. He did not pull any punches. He said that NASA is absolutely involved in the search for ET for direct contact, and this is part of their mission, and they are not going to stop. And for him to say that what's happening right now is extraterrestrial, and that he did not bounce around this, Whitley. That's what he said. Now, what ultimately is going on? It is that Bill's speech coming out of his mouth is based on what he actually knows. And it's the same thing with the Director of National Intelligence. All of the past directors of the CIA now have made statements over the last year. It is based on their knowledge and how that they have been approaching it. There's another key part to this, though. They are now figuring out, and I'm talking about the NSA, the CIA, the FBI, the DOD, the DNI, the NRO, the Navy, the Air Force. They now have found out in the harshest of ways that they have not been sharing information, that these agencies are sitting on information and haven't been sharing it with them. And so for the ODNI to have to step in and say, that's it. I am finding out about this third hand, and I this is the Office of the Director of National Intelligence. What is it that you know, CIA? What is it that you know, FBI? What is it that you know, U.S. Navy? We need to get this together. They've, you know, the proposition now for ASTRO, the UAP task force being dissolved and having a central depository of not only reports and information, but that this would get back centrally to ODNI so they can assess the situation. That's where we are right now. And I have never thought in my wildest dreams that we would get these agencies liable. This is statutory stuff that is coming in. This legislation that is coming in is not worded as these things that we need are a suggestion. No, we're talking about statutory movements here where this is now going to be regulated and required, part of the budget, and these things are demanded, and it is now a directorate. And it's a fascinating moment in time.
Jimmy Church, perfect way to end our year-end discussion. I'm sure we're going to have more discussions over the course of the year, and hopefully next year at this time we will be living in a different world and a better world, always, I hope. Jimmy Church can be reached very easily. Fade to Black is ubiquitous, but Jimmy, there's nothing like the guest describing how to get a hold of the guest, how to reach the guests. People listen to that much more carefully than they listen to the host, I have found. So tell us, how do we listen to Jimmy Church, and where and when?
Yeah, I've made it really complicated, Whitley. It's jimmychurchradio.com.
Right, exactly. jimmychurchradio.com. Jimmy is on, I think, four nights a week.
I'm on four nights a week, Monday through Thursday, and there's another part to this. I want to thank you for mentioning that, Whitley. We're also, you and I, we're on the UnX network together, too, as well, and everybody can go there. Big things for the UnX going in into 2022, and you're a part of that. I want to thank you. But all of the ways to listen or watch are all right there at jimmychurchradio.com. Whatever your flavor is, we're on the network, whether it's iHeartRadio or YouTube or our little membership area or Facebook or Twitter or wherever you tune in, whatever it is that you use and like to use, it's right there at jimmychurchradio.com.
Merry Christmas, Jimmy, and Happy New Year.
Whitley Strieber.
You're the man, Jimmy.
Thank you, Whitley. Have a great day. I know you're busy, and if you need anything else, just reach out to me. You know where I'm at.
Well, there you have it, the observers. Linda Moulton Howe and I will be here first week of January to continue this journey in some very unusual directions, and that's probably going to be the theme of Dreamland and Unknown Country for 2022. We're going to be going in some very unusual directions in our world, in our lives, and in this journey. This is my 21st year doing Dreamland, and I look back always with such fondness on all of those interviews on this incredible journey. And if you are not a subscriber, you should really become one, because there's no place like this in the world. And now I would like to conclude with our traditional New Year's ending. We'll listen to the unknowncountry.com singers, such as they are. If you listen closely, you'll hear Ann Strieber's voice in there singing Auld Lang Syne. Goodbye, 2021. Hello, future.
Should old acquaintance be forgot, and hands deep for us.